Welcome to my place. My place. My place.
How did you develop your holistic concept of life and music?
Well, I think perhaps it started very early. I was a horn player throughout high school, grade school. I played French horn, trumpet, trombone, valve trombone, and slide trombone, baritone horn. And it was my band teacher in high school that encouraged me, in much the way that Dizzy Gillespie encouraged Miles, to play piano as a way to envision and to visualize what you did on your horn from a broader perspective. And so he showed me some very basic things that basically painted a picture for me of the expansiveness and unlimited potential in terms of harmony. And of course, rhythm and harmony is what makes music what it is, and that's what makes life what it is. And so I started to understand the correlation between what I saw and what I heard. I guess the easiest example is how you go to a movie and you're sitting and watching the movie and you hear, and you don't really hear the music, but you feel it. And the music has the power to telegraph what's about to happen. Even if everything looks very calm and serene on this river, if you hear music that sounds somewhat ominous, then it lets you know that everything is not as it appears. And so so when you think about the power of music to shape perception and then to take that from the other side as the creator of that, to be able to shape your direction by creating things vibrationally that set up the next sequence of events.
Yeah.
And so things like Qigong and Tai Chi, these are things that when practiced holistically with diet, with understanding of the planets and our connection to them, and then we are able to flow and walk through life not always without surprise, but with a sense of adventure and discovery, so that when the so-called surprises appear, that we're able to flow with them.
Yeah.
So you have this thing coming at you, instead of freaking out, you just move inside and let it go.
Yeah. Do you think that mainstream music has been used in its most positive way, or has it been a negative on society? How do you see that?
Mainstream infers the bottom of the pyramid, and so the bottom of the pyramid is the most dense and wide part of the pyramid. And so when you think about the top of the pyramid, it's very small, and so that most people in the mainstream don't have a clue about the subtleties and the depth of what music is and the power of it. And so one thing that has happened as a result of that is that almost, I'd say 95% or more of mainstream music is in 4/4.
Yeah.
And at least in the Western world.
Yeah.
And so that has locked us into a cadence of life. And we walk And it's 4-4. We think in 4-4. We live in 4-4. We're in and four corners is a box.
A 4-4 prison. It's a 4x4 prison, isn't it?
But when you go to India and you hear the 7-4 rhythms, you hear all of the 9-4, 9-11s, it takes you out of the box. And that's why it said that jazz promotes abstract thinking, because even though most of it is in 4, within that structure, they break open that box improvisationally so that there's a freedom of expression that's not limited to any structure.
And it's also that chance to express a personality and for people to see a personality. If everything's 4-4, then you're all the same guys to me.
Exactly. So yeah, so when you talk about mainstream, then you're also talking about pop culture, which is orchestrated in a way to perpetuate itself. And so when you get outside of the box, you're said to be obsolete.
Yeah.
Or obscure, as it were. But then after the passage of time, you said to
do you think that
genius.
I mean, this 4-4 dominates the world.
It
needs time to catch up.
Yeah, it does. To the extent that those who march to the beat don't ever step outside. So I think that's sort of the beauty of what we're doing, is because we're using that 4-on-4, as I said, but then we're exploring the space in between. And we're juxtaposing it to a sense of freedom. And so that takes people, it gives them a glimpse outside of the prison window.
Yeah.
This could be,
how is it for you to move over to house music as well from jazz? Is that I suppose that's not such a big deal.
Well, I mean, I'm from Chicago, the birthplace of house music.
Yeah.
Prior to working with Miles, I did everything. I mean, I did country music. And while I was living in North Carolina, I did the music of Earth, Wind & Fire. I grew up on that. And at that time, there was no separation between the genres as there is now. Everything is very segmented, delineated categories. But then it was just music, you know. It was just all music. And so house music was thought of as music that's party music. It wasn't necessarily music that you turn on the radio all the time and hear, except for remixes of certain pop tunes. And so house music became part of a culture,
yeah,
sort of an underground culture of dance. I just saw recently a video on YouTube that took about 100 dance movies and cut it all together. And it was just like a nostalgic tale, basically, of where we began with this whole thing, all the way from Astaire to Travolta to all of them.
Yeah.
And it was amazing just to realize how much dance music really has had an influence on the cultures,
yeah,
worldwide. You know? And so it's a powerful vehicle for moving people. Remember the rave movements and how that was such a big thing in the States, where you'd have these secret
parties yeah,
in the woods somewhere. And actually, some of them were raided by the military.
Yeah.
So, you know, but it just shows that music has a power of attraction.
Well, in England, they've shut them down totally. You can't have raves now.
Yeah.
They're a bad influence for good thoughts.
Right.
Bad extremes of that, aren't they? People run away and play and they're in YouTube doing I don't know what. And
yeah.
Yeah, they have to play forever.
Yeah. But it's setting up whatever the next thing is, and I don't think we can even begin to imagine what the convergence of technologies and the convergence of consciousness can create. I mean, it's pretty far out there.
Yeah.